Well, welcome to 700 Club Interactive. In 2011, we celebrated the 400th anniversary of the King James Bible. Prior to this translation, the Bible was not available to everyone, only to church leaders who spoke Latin. And unfortunately, many courageous believers were persecuted so that we can have an English Bible.
This sacrifice is something that many Americans take for granted today. A recent study found that a surprising number of Christians can't even answer basic questions about their own religion. In fact, atheists and agnostics scored better on overall religious knowledge than many believers did. CBN's Wendy Griffith reports on this disturbing trend.
Can you just name any of the Ten Commandments for me?
Thou shalt not steal.
Thou shalt not commit adultery. Thou shalt not, what is it about brotherly name or something like that?
Where was Jesus born?
Oh, little town of
Bethlehem.
Can you quote John 3:16?
No, I can't.
Do you know the first and last book of the Bible?
The first is Genesis, right?
Genesis.
The last, I don't remember the last one.
Those answers would appear to back up the findings from a recent study on religious knowledge by the Pew Forum on Religion and Public Life. The poll asked 32 questions about all religions. The results showed atheists and agnostics, Jews and Mormons got more answers right than Protestants and Roman Catholics. On questions about Christianity and the Bible, Mormons scored the highest with an average of about 8 correct answers out of 12, followed closely by white evangelicals. Still, atheists and agnostics knew more about Christianity than black Protestants and white Catholics. Surveys have long shown that Bible literacy is falling among Americans and evangelicals. Autumn Black with the American Bible Society says it's impossible to be literate about something you never read.
I've heard stories of people in China tearing out, having one page and, you know, distributing it amongst the village, and just everybody clings to that one page of the Bible. And we have, you know, depending on which study you read, up to 3 to 6 Bibles on our shelves per household that are just kind of dusty. You know, you have to kind of blow it off when you open it up.
Black says the problem is many people don't see the Bible as being relevant to their lives. However, studies show just the opposite is true.
And when it comes to the question of what the Bible says about life after death, most of the people we talk to, even some who claim to be Christians, say you can get to heaven simply by being a good person. If you were to die tonight, God forbid, would you go to heaven and why?
Probably heaven. I try and treat people well. I think that's the most important, you know, of all the rules of life.
Why would I go to heaven? Well, I believe in heaven. I believe in heaven, and I also feel that I have not committed any real crimes.
Still, many like this young man who claims to be a Christian say Jesus is not the only way to heaven.
But you don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
Not the Son of God. He said he was a Son of God, never said he was the Son of God.
Black says if Bible illiteracy continues at its current rate, Christianity itself is in danger.
We've got to mobilize the church, because by 2040, if we don't, there'll be no Christianity in America.
Wendy Griffith, CBN News.
Well, for more on this story, we've got the author of Passages, How Reading the Bible in a Year Will Change Everything for You. It's Brian Harden. And Brian, welcome to the 700 Club Interactive.
Thanks. It's an honor to be here today.
Why, you've got a chapter in your book, you know, Why Don't We Read the Bible? And so why don't we?
Yeah, I think you laid it out really good in that setup. All of those reasons are what people are saying. For me, what I'm finding and what was true, because I was one of those people, I was one of those guys. For me, it changed when I began to read the Bible in context, rather than trying to go from one promise verse or one piece of comfort pulled out of context to the next just to try to get me through or to look pretty for Jesus so he would save me from whatever my troubles were. And reading it in the context as part of a greater story, a story that I'm involved in. A lot of people think that scripture is antiquated or has some sort of, context that has no bearing on what it actually will be saying. And so I find it that the story part of this is the most important part that we have.
Well, you're coming to us from your studio where you created a whole series of podcasts where you did an audio version where you could have a daily podcast of the Bible. What was the inspiration for that, and then how successful did it become?
Daily Audio Bible started January 1st, 2006, so we just celebrated an anniversary. And it was the biggest thing that I have ever done in obedience to God. I was a record producer, so I'm sitting here in a studio that I made records in, always behind the mic, always happy to be behind the mic. And I woke up from a dream just before Christmas in 2005. And I heard this voice say, I want you to podcast the Bible, which was the strangest thing that I had ever heard of in my life. I'd always been the behind the scenes guy. And so stepping out front was definitely not on my radar, but I obeyed that. I still scratch my head why. And I still think often I had to be God's like 30th choice for this. But I started to podcast the Bible January 1st, 2006. And it grew from zero to 200,000 downloads in the first 6 months. We've crossed 48 million downloads by the end of 2011 and are well on our way to tracking all of the 1.5 to 2 million downloads per month that we've had all along.
Let me pick up on something that you said earlier about the Bible. We need to read it as a story. And we need to read the verses in the context of a story. Are you finding that the success of the audio version of what you're doing is related to people really want to hear the story? Is that part of the appeal?
I think that's part of it. I think the spoken word of God has power. I think that we've kind of decided that the Bible is something that we're supposed to ingest quietly and serenely and individually, whereas the spoken word of God has just as much power, if not more power. In fact, the Bible comes originally in an oral tradition. And so obviously the spoken word of God is something that's very powerful. The story aspect, for sure. I mean, I used to think, you know, going through some of the genealogies was so tedious. And a lot of people say that. Why is this stuff in the Bible, all these lists of names? But when you begin to read things in context, you realize, okay, every one of these names has a life behind it, and a life lived, a story lived, a part of God's story moving forward. And what about all these customs? I don't understand all of this. But when you read the story in context, you realize the humanity of it. And you realize that even though there's a different cultural overlay to who we are now, the heart of man is unchanged. And so the humanity that is in the Bible is really beautiful and striking. And so there's not a day that goes by that I'm not reading the Bible feeling as if I'm looking in a mirror.
Well, you're hitting on a good point within the genealogies. When you just look at the stories behind the people, there's a whole lot of good theology. I love reading the stories of the women listed in the genealogy of Jesus, and you have the whole story of redemption just in the lives of the women that are listed there. You also talk about reading the Bible, and your book focuses in on perhaps we're not reading it properly, in that you've found a technique in what I'll call the mystics of the church, the monastery tradition. Tell us about that.
Oh, Lectio Divina is the act of taking a portion of Scripture and inviting the Holy Spirit to speak to us through that portion of Scripture. So the mystics of the church, or the ancient desert fathers, would have called this kind of chewing on it. They used to use the analogy of a cow chewing its cud slowly, methodically, unhurriedly. And so often we're going to our devotions as something that we have to either just fit in somehow really quick so that we can feel good about our devotional life or feel good that we've given God some time, rather than creating space to allow God to truly speak to us. When we fall in love with our spouse, time ceases to exist. We may show up for work, but we can't wait for that clock to end so that we can get with that person and go spend as much time as possible. And the time just seems to fly by. We don't normally think of that in terms of scripture or relationship with God. But the irony is that we can. And if we devote ourselves and give ourselves to a relationship, a friendship with scripture, then the time begins to fly by because God begins to speak to the truer, deeper, more honest places of who we are. So this practice of Lectio Divina that I talk about in the book just kind of re-examines something that has been in Christian practice for a couple of thousand years and just gives us permission to make space for God to speak through his word.
Oh, it's been around for a long time. You go back into the book of Genesis, you find the first mention of it. It's Isaac was out in the field meditating, and that's when he met his bride. She appeared on the horizon as he was meditating at the end of the day. What are some practical tips? I know if you put a Bible in front of somebody and say, okay, I want you to read this in a year, a lot of people will say, I don't think I can do that. And I know a lot of Christians, have you ever read through the Bible is a question that they'll answer, no, I've never done that. But how can someone read through the Bible and literally do that every year and be confident that you can accomplish it in a year?
Well, I think it starts with maybe an understanding of what it is you're reading. And I think the paradigm shift is that it's not this manual meant to give you instructions that will cage your life and make you feel as if you are always on the losing end, that you'll never measure up to this. I think it is the pathway to a life of humanity that we were created to live. So for starters, reading the Bible is simply instructing us on the ways of life rather than the parameters we must stay inside. But I also think that the story aspect is very important. God speaks to us through these stories, and we find ourselves in these stories. We become friends, as it were, with these people, and we become friends with the Bible. I have often said, the Bible is the best friend you've never had. You just don't know it. We find ourselves in the cloud or the malaise or the fog of life, chaos swirling all around us. And we might shake our fist at the sky and say, why won't you tell me what to do? Or talk to our friends and say, God has stopped speaking to us. But if we were asked, well, what is your relationship like with God's word? What's your relationship like with the Bible? The answer is usually, what do you mean? I read it from time. I read it at church. I read it from time to time. And yet this is God's word. So there's never a time, at least in this point in history, in the West, that anybody should ever be able to say, well, God has just stopped speaking to me. We have his word. We have it freely. We have it readily available. We have it in every format imaginable. There's never a time that we shouldn't be able to turn to the counsel of the Creator and understand what he is saying to our lives.
And he'll say very unusual things to you, like, I want you to podcast the Bible.
For sure.
Which is a whole new adventure. When you really tune your ear to his voice, it's incredible what can happen. Well, Brian, thanks for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
Well, his book is of Passages. It's available wherever books are sold. We also have links available on our website if you want to start subscribing to his podcast to get the Audible Bible so you can experience it every day for yourself and in spoken form. And if you're interested in reading the Bible, CBN has some tools as well to help. All you have to do is register online, and every morning we'll send you a daily scripture reading from both the Old and the New Testament, and it'll allow you to read through the entire Bible. If you don't want to take that on, you can have a daily scripture that'll be a much shorter version. But if you sign up for that, read the Bible through the year, it's a couple of chapters every day. And if you just say, okay, I'm going to do this every day, you'll read through the Bible in a year. All you have to do is go to 700clubinteractive.com and sign up today. Terry, over to you.
Coming up, a young mother shares one of her favorite childhood memories with her son. Hear what they are right after this.
It's hard to believe it's been 8 years since I made that commercial. And now I'm a 10-year survivor.
Today's a special day, a big milestone to me. I'm out here riding my horse, appreciating every minute of it.
My life changed the day I was diagnosed with cancer. It was hard when I was lying in the hospital and didn't know if anybody survived pancreatic cancer, that I decided, if I survive this, I want to offer hope to somebody else and to show them that there are people out there like Cancer Treatment Centers of America who can make a difference.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and late-stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com. You'll be able to see our treatment results for many types of cancers and how they compare to national averages. You can also check for participating insurance plans.
The doctors looked over what they needed to do for me, but the decision was always mine.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, every resource, every one of us, everything we do every day is focused on you, our patient, your treatment, your healing, your survival.
After cancer now, I just appreciate life so much more. I appreciate the little things. Being able to carry a bucket of water for my horse again was like winning a marathon. Not 1 hour goes by that I don't stop and think about how fortunate I was to have found CTCA.
Our teams of physicians, clinicians, and nurses are highly experienced and dedicated. We use state-of-the-art technology and give you innovative treatment options you may not even know exist. You'll also experience whole-person compassionate care here, unlike anything you've seen before.
When I talk to people and they said, oh my gosh, a 10-year survivor, I can't believe it. Life is good and I just appreciate it totally. I'm doing things I never dreamt I would do.
Call or go to cancercenter.com today to learn more about our unique approach to state-of-the-art cancer care. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
As a young girl, Jasmine loved the idea of school because for her, school meant sitting at home and watching Superbook.
Before Jasmine Willerer was old enough to go to kindergarten, she loved to play school time at home in the Philippines. That's because it included watching one of her favorite TV shows.
So every time Superbook would come on and a string of other childhood cartoons, I would put one of my sister's uniform and watch in front of the TV, and that would be my school.
Jasmine loved the show so much, she prayed that she could be a Superbook character.
And here are all the other kids with a magic book that transports them into Jesus time, which is even more special.
Now that Jasmine's a mom, she wants her son to learn those stories too. And what better way than through the new HD version of Superbook?
I want him to watch Superbook because I want him to be exposed and understand stories about Jesus, stories about the Bible.
What can one child not do when that child goes with God?
So something that he will enjoy at his age and we'll be able to carry on with him throughout later in life.
If you want to be a part of Superbook, we're reimagining it for a whole new generation. And our goal here is to bring the Bible to the children of the world and do it in story form, to tell them the stories of the Bible. And what happens is two kids from modern day, Chris and Joy, go off with their robot Gizmo into adventures in Superbook, and they travel back in time to witness the Bible story. Our first season, 13 episodes, starts in Genesis and goes all the way to when Jesus returns. So if you just watch the first season, you get the major stories of the Bible. But we're building it out. We've got season 2 in production, another 13 episodes. We're already starting to do the scripts for season 3, yet another 13 episodes. And we need help with the production. We need help with the translation. We're translating it into 20 different languages so the children of the world can get the Bible and get it in a form that they love and want to come back and watch again and again. And on top of all of that, when the Bible characters are speaking, they're speaking verses from the Bible. We're trying to be historically accurate. We're trying to be biblically accurate. And you can be a part of it by helping us. And what we're asking for is a gift of $25 or more. And we'll put that to the production cost, the translation cost, the distribution cost of Superbook. So if you want to be a part of it, call us, 888-777-1999. And for a gift of $25 or more, we'll send Roar to you. It's the story of Daniel in the Lion's Den. That's the latest episode. It's being released today. So if you want that, ask for Roar. And we encourage you, when you call, ask for the DVD Club, the Superbook DVD Club. When you join the Superbook DVD Club, we'll send more than just the one episode. We'll give you two more in these smaller cases where you can share them with your family, friends, with your church, your Sunday school. We want to get the stories out. We want to enable you to be able to give the Bible to your friends and loved ones. So ask for the DVD Club. Now, what that means is every 4 to 6 weeks, as the new episodes are issued, you'll be first in line. We'll ship it out to you automatically. We'll charge your credit card, debit card, $25, and you'll be assured that you'll get it. And not only will you get the single episode, you'll get the two additional ones, so you can give them away and give them to friends and family. So if you want the DVD Club, ask for that. You can sign up online on CBN.com, or you can call us, 888-777-1999. Terry?
I'm joining the club. That's a great deal.
You're going for it.
I'm going for it. Well, coming up, a porn addict was on the verge of a mental breakdown. Hear how he silenced the voices in his head. That's next on 700 Club Interactive.
I skated every single day. There's definitely years that I didn't miss a single day of skateboarding.
A skateboarder leaves behind his wild ways to answer a deeper calling.
It's not one bit about, you know, what am I going to do in this world? It's what am I going to do that the Lord has called me to do today? It's good news. Are we scared of sharing good news? Hey, I don't want to tell anybody that I got, you know, like, really? Like, share good news. If it's good to you, if it's good to me, it's good to them.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
For years, Eric Bledsoe was at war with his own mind. He wanted to get clean, he wanted to fight his addiction, and yet the more Eric fought, the worse he got, and the fight was driving him crazy.
I woke up in the middle of the night, and I'm not a weird guy, but I swear to you, it was like almost audibly like taunting me.
Eric Bledsoe was held captive by pornography. He sat home alone day after day.
When you're alone with your thoughts, sitting on the couch, it's awful. I felt and knew that something was so broken and so wrong in my heart.
He grew up in church and accepted Christ when he was 6 years old, but walked away after a humiliating conflict with Christian leaders during college.
I became very hurt and very bitter. I chose to run towards whatever would take me in.
Eric dropped out of school and eventually moved to Nashville to pursue a music career. Alone in a new city, Eric turned to pornography for comfort.
I just didn't want anything or anyone, and this was the only thing that I could turn to, I thought. Pornography was a great narcotic because it was whatever I wanted it to be. It lies to you that it will fulfill you, and then as soon as you've given yourself to it, it stabs you in the back.
He eventually turned to women for companionship and bounced from one promiscuous relationship to the next.
I needed intimacy to feel loved, to feel like I was validated as a man, to feel in control because my whole life was in a tailspin, to feel a sense of belonging to anything.
He also started going to a strip club.
That was my moment of, I am sick.
I'm in a strip club, but yet I can't even enjoy it because I'm so overcome with compassion for this person because I want them to be whole, and yet I'm in the same boat as she is.
Eric ran to the only people he could trust, his parents.
They didn't know any of the things that I was doing. Got in a huge fight about the purpose and value of my life, and it got so bad that eventually they just said, look, we love you, and we are out of our league here. You need some help.
He went to see a physician whose prescription caught him off guard.
He sat down, and he asked me 1,000 questions with his chart, and they started off medical, and they went more and more personal and psychological at some point. And he said, Eric, the way that you believe and the things that you do are in such contradiction to each other that I think as your doctor that you're going crazy. He said, if I were you, as your medical doctor, not your pastor, I think the best prescription I could write you is for you to go to church.
Eric drove home to Nashville and called a friend who just happened to be going to a Christian conference. He invited Eric to go along.
I knew that I couldn't say no to the Lord forever. And all of those fears and emotions and shame and guilt are so loud in my head, and they are playing like a tape over and over. You need to get out. You should not be here. Wait till they find out what you've done. All of the things. They're going to reject you again. It's going to happen, blah, blah, blah. Oh, it's so loud.
He walked forward that night to rededicate his life to Christ.
When I set my face to walk down the aisle, it just stopped. Me putting my foot in the aisle and walking up front to talk to anybody required absolute surrender because of how far I had been.
Eric began studying the Bible and found a man who would mentor him.
I was going to die if I didn't change. And it might not have been the week after, but I was on a path to either take my own life or lose it. And just out of sheer depression and loneliness. And the only thing that I have ever seen, that I have ever heard work, is when you cultivate such a relationship with Christ that it becomes a greater high than logging onto porn, to be chaste and holy unto God. So much so that to sell out for porn is like a joke. I'm practicing renewing my mind, being around men and women of God, trying to listen to the Holy Spirit, being in church, doing the right things. And slowly over time, one thing is replaced for another, and eventually it just clicked.
Today, Eric is married with a young son.
I long to be faithful to my wife now. Why would I give up my home, my marriage, and my family for 15 minutes with a computer? I mean, come on. There is a place that is only meant for God. And when we try to take anything that's not God and fill that void in us with it, we also end up more empty and more alone and more depressed. There is a God who sees you, Jesus, who knows the things that you're choosing over Him, the things that you've been a part of, and He is waiting to forgive you for those things. He has decided that He would rather die than live without you.
He's waiting to forgive you. He already loves you. He already loves you. We can't ever get good enough to come to God. He doesn't ask that of us. He's saying, let me come into the place of your need. Let me make those things right. Let me strengthen what has been lost and depleted and diminished in you. And whether you're someone who's addicted to porn and the struggle that Eric had, or you've got some other issue in your life. I mean, sin is sin, and it's everywhere. It's everywhere. Question is, what are we going to do about the fact that we are sinners in need of a Savior? Jesus came for exactly that reason. He didn't come because He just wanted to clean us up a little bit. He came because He wanted to change us, to make us whole, to give us a fresh beginning, to give us the power to be set free from things that have crept into our hearts and minds and lives that are slowly destroying us. And boys, I know some of you can relate to what Eric said about how loud those voices are. When you're in a wrong place, when you're not walking with the Lord, when you know truth, and yet you're not surrendering to God, you're not letting Him be God in your life. Oh, how it can tear you up. But God is always there, never forsaking, never not seeing you as His child, never not loving you, always available for the asking. He says, call on me, and that when we seek after Him, We'll find him, but seek with all of your heart and surrender to him. God loves you. We'll see you again later.